Hey y'all, it's Stephen Van Kampen-Lewis, and today I am experimenting with some Cattleya seeds. I have some of these rupiculous Cattleyas. You may know them as rupiculous lelias or Hoffman sagella. I'm just gonna call them rupiculous Cattleyas. But I've got seeds from two different species, Rupestris and Mirandi. And what I'm gonna do today is see if I can get them to germinate in some sand. And it's not just ordinary sand. Well, I guess it is. The sand itself is pretty ordinary. But when I went to Brazil earlier this year, I grabbed some rocks, just some small ones from rupiculous Cattleya habitat. And I brought it back as gifts for my kids. And as you can imagine, they simply went on a shelf and no one ever saw them again. And I realized that there might be some beneficial microorganisms on there, hopefully fungi, that can bond with the Cattleya seeds and then create this symbiosis, at least in the short term. And what happens is wild Cattleya seed or most wild orchid seed requires some fungus to get into the seed and then start feeding the orchid itself, and then the orchid gives back some sort of protection or something. At least in the short term, it's a symbiotic relationship. Then the orchid actually ends up consuming the fungi, so it doesn't really work out super well for the fungi in the end. But you know, it's an evolutionary relationship that's likely many millions of years old, so it seems to be working for both of them. Regardless, what I'm gonna do is I have been sort of inoculating some sand around these rocks, and I've been occasionally watering them with the same sort of really, really low dose fertilizer and pure water spray that I give to my orchids inside that are in the cabinet right over here. And so hopefully this has enabled the fungi, I don't know how many are in there, to sort of spread throughout the sand matrix. And hopefully that creates a hospitable environment for these seeds. And so what I wanna do is just take a tiny little pinch of each and then sprinkle them on top of the sand. You'll see this in a second. And I have these tags with the names written on them. And then I've got a little lid on top. I'm not gonna cinch it down real tight because I want some kind of airflow in there. And then I have my spray bottle, which I will spray probably like 3 times a week. And this is just pure water with a tablespoon a teaspoon of sugar mixed in. And I got this recipe from my friend Lauan in Brazil, and he uses this to sprout all kinds of things, especially Cattleya nobiliores, on just wood, basically. And so what he'll do is he'll sprinkle some seed and then spray this every, you know, 2 or 3 days. And you can see the water here is a little brown. You can see that I've had a little bit of Jim's Purely Organic here in the bottom, and there's some residue, and that's causing the water to be brown. I put in basically 2 large pinches, and we'll see. You can see some chunks floating around in there probably, and if you can't, they're there. So that may end up clogging this, and if that's true, I'll just get another one. This is all experimental, and if I do have to get another one, then I'll just go back straight to the sugar and the water. And that's it. So I will have them underneath the lights in my IKEA grow cube, I guess. And then, you know, over the next weeks to months to years, if all goes right, I will share the results with you, and we'll see if we can do sort of a low-tech way to seed or to sprout seeds for these Cattleyas. And I have a bunch of these seeds, and then I'll send a bunch more out for actual flasking, so that most of these can get into production and be sent around. But let's get the camera sort of top-down view, and then I will show you the setup itself, as well as sprinkling the seeds. All right, so here it is in all of its glory. This basically Thai food container that has been repurposed with sand and labels. So, like I mentioned, Cattleya rupestris is the one here on the left, and Cattleya mirandi is going to be here receiving seeds on the right. So basically what I'm going to do is I'm just going to eyeball this and partition it. And I want to get seeds in the sand as well as on top of some of the rocks. And you can see there's quite a bit of lichen here growing on this. So I want to see if I can get some seeds on here and then down below, sort of all around. And I will show you actually some Cattleya seeds right now. So these are the Cattleya seeds, and I don't know if you can see them very well. So let me turn off the light here, and that will help you to see a little bit better the seeds themselves. And so we have the rupestris seeds here and the mirandi seeds here. And let's see if I can zoom in a little bit. And so you can see just how tiny those things are. And since they're still in a big batch like that, I'll show you this video that really shows a couple of the rupestris seeds that I spilled, and then I put a penny next to them. So you can see a size differential of the individual seeds themselves. And you can see just why they're so small, or that they're so small. And you can see why they need a symbiotic fungus to germinate. And in fact, here's a quick video that I shot while I was in Brazil of some rupiculous Cattleya seeds blowing away in the wind, and that is their typical normal dispersal mechanism. All right, so you can see that I've pre-moistened this. There is water here, and you can see that the water droplets there on the name tags. And so what I'm gonna do now is take a little bit of this seed and sprinkle it around on each side. I'm going to start with a knife, sort of getting some of the, delicately breaking these up. This looks an awful lot like some of those movies that we have seen, from the 80s, typically set in Miami. So I have this little bit left here. Just kind of trying to sprinkle it around a little bit without damaging the seeds themselves too much, because as you can imagine, these things are going to be incredibly delicate. And then I want to look at the tip of my knife here to make sure that there's no additional seeds there. And so similarly, they'll just kind of spread it around. Not sure how good of a job I'm doing at keeping it somewhat evenly spread, or if I'm even worse, mixing some of the seeds up, especially here in the middle. I don't know that it matters too much, because we'll be able to figure it out later. But this is the experiment. I'll make sure that I get all of these seeds off here. I think that's good enough. And then I want to get my homemade spray here, just to sort of cement these seeds into the sand and onto the rocks and really get this process started. And like I mentioned, I'm going to take this and just gently place it on top. I'm not gonna squish it down. And then I'm gonna put it back into the cabinet. And in fact, I'll put it back and I'll show you what it looks like. Okay, and As you can see, this box is now in here underneath the lights inside the orchid cabinet. And that's where this one will stay until the seedlings, if they pop up, start hitting the roof of this lid, and then I'll take it off and then figure out what I want to do with it afterwards. And so hopefully I'll start to see things sprout up in maybe a month or 3 to 4 weeks. And then if they're actually the seeds and not just sort of some other algae or whatever, they'll start to grow. They'll turn into little teeny tiny round protocorms. And then those protocorms will eventually get roots and eventually have leaves and turn into the typical orchids that we see here that we are familiar with. And yes, this is a bloom spike of Kampen-Lewis coccinea. So I'm excited to see what that one looks like. I've never seen one of those in real life. And that comes from a recent import from South America, from Peru specifically. Anyway, so that's today's video. I hope you all have a great weekend, and I will talk to you later.